Well, I started with the failure thing because it's something that, you know, everyone can relate to. And yours specifically was you started a business, you got investors, it was doing well, but there was a problem within it that then the business failed. When did you decide, I think I should talk about this? Because you didn't have to.
It's true. And I think the default in the startup world is not to talk about it, right? We go to great lengths to find ways to spin it, right? We often talk about acqui-hires, which is getting acquired for literally just your team, or selling the IP of your company to someone else for like a dollar so that you can claim to be acquired. And that was certainly one path we could have taken, but I knew that this was going to be a defining moment in my life. You can tell in the moment, right? This is one of those things. And I knew that at some point I was going to want to tell the truth. And if we tried to spin it in the moment, even if it wasn't lying exactly, I was always going to have to kind of use that version of the story. And I thought it would be just so much more freeing to be able to talk about what actually happened. And I think truly, I decided to talk more openly about it once I got back on my feet and I was interviewing for my next job. I was completely broke and I had to pay rent. So I was like, okay, let's get a job quick now. And I had all of these conversations and no one held my failure against me. They all were interested in what I learned about it, under what conditions I would try again, what I was thinking about, you know, what direction to go into next, but no one held that up as some, you know, moral shortcoming or evidence that I couldn't do it, or even bad judgment that I tried something that was potentially outside of my, you know, capacity at that time. So that was the point when I was like, whoa, this thing that I have feared my entire life is actually not world ending. And I kind of want more high achieving folks to know that.
So many good takeaways from what you said. And whether it's business or a relationship or a move across the country that didn't work or an effort to have children, like fill in the blank with whatever you might think is the worst failure that ever happened to you, whether it's even true that it is or isn't a failure. It's two things. You didn't start talking about it the next day. Like you gave it some space to kind of put it in perspective. And then no one held it against you because guess what? The person sitting across the table from you was probably like, oh, yeah, been there.
For sure. And I think I fully did not grasp how many people have been fired, have been laid off, have tried something professionally and it didn't work. Certainly all the personal examples that you just gave. I was 27, 28. And I had only ever succeeded at every juncture in my life up to that point. And that was the narrative. That was the story I told myself, was like, I am someone who succeeds. And it did not even register how many people I looked up to and wanted to model my life after who had had big, painful failures. And part of it is because we don't really talk about those.
That is such an unfortunate reality. Even, you know, I've watched documentaries or docudramas about different startups that made it household names. I mean, WeWork is the first one that comes to mind where I would say that that gentleman failed. No shame in that. He failed.
Yes.
And yet he's to this day won't talk about it as a failure. And that's, I think, to your point, doing a disservice to all the other startup folks out there and people who believe that I have an idea, people invest in my idea, people want to buy my idea, therefore I define myself and my identity is in being successful, even though you're robbing other people the opportunity to learn.
Well, you're also robbing yourself that opportunity, right? So in my book, I point to some research from Dr. Seligman, Martin Seligman, who is sort of the father of positive psychology, who studied failures a lot. And he points to one of the biggest tools that you can use to turn a failure into not just something you recover from, but something you actually grow from, requires meaning making from that failure. It requires putting it into the context of who you are, what you do, how this has impacted you. It requires some storytelling. And if you can't admit that it was a failure, if you're always going to spin it, even to yourself, then you're not going to reap the benefits of actually growing from this. You might recover, but you're not going to leap forward. And that's one of the things that I really believe about that failure. I leapt forward 5+ years in my career by putting myself in important situations where my decisions mattered, where I was held accountable for really tough decisions, and then seeing the cost when I made the wrong decisions. That's something that you often don't get to experience until mid-career. And I got to experience it earlier. And that prepared me for leadership and for the next time I was in those seats so much faster. But I had to be able to acknowledge I made the wrong decisions and I failed.
So wise. I love the meaning making, because then you're getting really honest with yourself, what happened, and then what can I learn from it? Not how can I spin mm-hmm. it so that it wasn't my fault. I mean, mm-hmm. I say it regularly. My business started because I was laid off. And I think everyone in their life should be laid off, because mm-hmm. you don't have to really look in the mirror and say, who am I? What is my purpose on this planet? What do I like to do? What should I be doing? Are all parts of my life healthy right now? You don't do that when you're in the grind of doing things. Mm-hmm. But once you have someone say, you know what, no longer are you part of this mm-hmm. organization, relationship, whatever it might be, then you get to the facts.
Well, and this is really important. Your example of being laid off is a great one, certainly that a number of folks are experiencing right now, because sometimes failures have nothing to do with us. They're things outside of our control, right? It could be that you're laid off because you're a bottom performer and they want to cut headcount. But it also could be that someone just said, hey, trim 15%. I don't care how you get there. And somehow your name gets on that list, right? And I really define failure as just the thing happened different from what you wanted to happen. It could very well be something you did wrong. It could be something that happened outside of your control, but you start to recognize that there are going to be lots of moments in life where things don't turn out the way you wanted. And being prepared for that and being able to, in the example of being laid off, being able to find your identity separate from your work, and at the same time, not internalize the shame or the responsibility for a decision that actually you didn't make, right? So there's as much meaning making in recognizing when this failure was not your fault, when this was outside of your control, as there is when it is in your control. And I think both of these situations are going to hit everybody, personal, professional, in every context, over the course of a long life. So you have to be prepared for processing that and not just skirting past it.
And dwelling on the past, which I think the way that, you know, you talked about it is so healthy, and yet most people don't do it that way. And the temptation, especially now, I have never been a man, so I don't know, but I have found it more that women take it on, do the blaming, do the shaming. Mm-hmm. What did I do wrong? What part of this is mine to own? And there's certainly some, you know, perhaps value depending upon the situation, but then what did I learn from it? And where am I going to take it? I've mm-hmm. had, you know, in a personal setting, women who have husbands have left them, for example, mm-hmm. what if this is my fault? It's like, whoa. I mean, that is not perhaps going to serve you mm-hmm. when really this someone else made a decision, but we do it so often. And then I think when mm-hmm. we get in that dwelling spot and like, what did I do wrong? You can't move forward because you can just spin.
That's right. And there certainly is research to back this up, that women internalize failures more on average, and men externalize failures more on average. They're more likely to say, oh, well, the circumstances around me were the reason I failed. And women are more likely to say it was my fault. And there's definitely some socialization in there. There's just some gender biases, right, in how we raise boys and girls. But certainly it is not helpful to spin your wheels and own a situation that is not on you. You will learn the wrong lessons from that. I certainly, in a number of kind of early failed relationships, tried to learn the wrong lesson of all the ways that I should change in order to, you know, be a better partner, until one point I finally realized, no. I'm looking for the wrong kind of partner, apparently. Certainly there's some learnings I can put to bear on how I vet my partners, how I build that relationship, how I communicate, but I am who I am. And what I need to be doing is find someone who wants me. And that's true in all contexts. I call myself a very strangely shaped puzzle piece, and I embrace that weirdness. I'm very proud of that weirdness. But it took me a long time to recognize that I just need to find the rooms that want me, rather than trying to shave off my weirdness and the corners and the jagged edges and try to like mash myself into a little standard puzzle piece that might be available, the only spot left in the puzzle. You're like, no, that's just not for you. And that's not your fault. It's just not for you. Go where you're wanted. And I would chalk that up to a failure too, right? Like, it's not what I thought would happen. But again, it's not some giant big F, you know, branded on my forehead for all time. And I think that's what's so powerful. You know, I allowed one of my investors, who is also my professor at Harvard Business School, to write the case study on our failure. And a couple of years after we shut down, and he started teaching it at Harvard Business School, and then it got picked up by all the top business schools, and then it got picked up by undergraduate schools, and now it's taught all over the world. And I go to as many of these classes as I can. I now teach it as a professor. I sort of put on my professor hat and talk about myself in the third person. It's very strange. But I find it so fascinating how unbelievable it is to these high-achieving students that someone could fail, speak openly about it, show their face, listen to the conversation about those shortcomings, and not be defensive. And I think modeling that might be one of the most important things I've ever done.